So I want to talk about the relationship between cortisol and protein. A lot of people don't understand this, but there's a huge connection with cortisol, the stress hormone, and the breakdown of protein in the body. So I want to kind of show you kind of some overviews of what happens. Protein breaks down into amino acids. And if you know, there's a lot of people right now with, they have a lot of neurotransmitter problems. They have depression, they have attention deficit disorder, they have anxiety, and they're trying to take psych drugs to improve the neurotransmitters, right? My question is, why? Why can't they get it from the diet? What's the problem? What's causing this amino acid issue? A lot of hormones are made from amino acids. Why do people have hormone problems? Why is their immune system so bad? Why do they have bone loss and muscle loss? That's called atrophy, muscle loss. So there's a couple things that allow this process to occur when you consume protein to make amino acids and turn them into body tissue and neurotransmitters. One is you need enzymes from the pancreas. So let's say the person's a diabetic or they've eaten a lot of sugar and they damage the pancreas. That could be one big factor that they're not breaking down into the amino acids to be able to make these neurotransmitters anymore. It could be also they're eating all cooked foods, you know. It could be dietary. It could be that they're not consuming enough protein. I didn't even put that on there, but that's kind of rare. Or it could be the stomach. They don't have enough hydrochloric acid, and they have heartburn, and they have digestive problems, and they're taking antacids or whatever. That could be the reason why they're not getting these as well, digestive problems. Or it could be lower in the digestive tract. They don't have the friendly bacteria to really break down these proteins as well, because that is something, not only the stomach, but the microbes help you make amino acids as well. Okay, the number one thing though is the high cortisol. That's really what will prevent this process from occurring. And this comes from stress. So cortisol creates a catabolic effect. Comes from the word cannibalistic, cannibal. Cannibal eats flesh, okay? Catabolic hormones break down things. They break down muscle protein. So with the cortisol, this high stress, these amino acids are not absorbed in the muscle. So you get a catabolic effect of the muscle. You get breakdown, atrophy of the muscle. You get muscle wasting with cortisol. That's why during stress or menopause, when the adrenal backs up the ovary, you see these people just like getting all flabby. So that's atrophy of the muscle. Amino acids do not get absorbed into the muscle if the cortisol is high. The bone is not just calcium. It's a lot of collagen. It's a lot of protein. So the bone also doesn't get the amino acids too. So you have bone loss. Okay? But third, the lymph system, the lymphatic, the lymph nodes, that's part of the immune system. It actually shrinks and it atrophies as well. It's called lysis, which is it breaks down. The lymph breaks down. And what happens is it releases antibodies. And I want to get into that in a little bit. But first, let me just kind of tell you what happens. So we have the suffering of all the body tissues involved with protein, muscle, tendon, ligament, bone, lymph. All these things don't get the proper amino acids. So now what happens is these amino acids go instead to the liver. And they go through a process called deamination, okay? Deamination. And this basically is a term of breakdown of amino acids. And so, in other words, the liver will break down these amino acids into ammonia and carbon skeletons and the hydrogen ion, okay? So the ammonia turns into urea or urine, or uric acid. And that's why people get gout, because they can't, this builds up too much because the liver is damaged, okay? Or the kidney's damaged. But carbon skeleton forms carbohydrates and glucose. In other words, your body is converting amino acid to sugar, to glucose. Yeah, that's interesting. The hydrogen ion, that goes out to the urine, and wherever the hydrogen ion goes, so does the potassium. So you lose potassium. And then when you lose potassium, you become very, very alkaline, and it throws off the pH, and you can't absorb, oh my gosh, calcium, and you have all these issues. All right. Why? Why is the body doing all this? Because it's in a survival mode. It must create a secondary fuel source. And what it does is it causes gluconeogenesis. Gluco, meaning sugar, neo, new, genesis, create. So the body is creating new sugar from protein, from amino acids. So it'll basically allow the rest of the body to go to hell in a handbasket as long as it gets its fuel. So, but the problem is all this carbon atoms that it's kind of pulling, carbon skeletons, it's forming glucose, will start spiking the blood sugar and spiking the insulin and causing diabetes and belly fat and high cholesterol. Okay? Now, there's some other things that I want to talk about with this lymph. When you release the antibodies, you also then, with a smaller lymph system, start decreasing the production of antibodies. So you don't actually produce these antibodies like you did before. And you also do not create the cellular barriers and the resistance against infections. So you have a lowered resistance and the susceptibility factor. And that's what causes the autoimmune disease. Autoimmune diseases are the loss of tolerance or to differentiate from an invader, healthy tissue, self and non-self. Okay, so your body starts attacking itself. That's what an autoimmune thing is. And if you ask any person who had autoimmune diseases, when did it start? It always happened after a stress event or a loss of a loved one or a divorce, and they start getting this because it stresses the cortisol. Cortisol is the main source of problems with autoimmune diseases. Why? Because it's used as the main cure, or not cure, but treatment. What do they give all autoimmune diseases? They inject them with prednisone, cortisol. But they don't take it back and look at what happened first. The first thing is that there's a spike in cortisol, and there's this whole reaction that occurs. You lose your lymphatic system, your immune system, and your antibodies go out of control, and you become susceptible, and then boom, you start getting a loss of tolerance to other tissues. So there's a delicate balance of your body determining what's a good cell, what's a bad cell, what's a good microbe, what's a bad friendly bacteria, unfriendly. And when it loses control, it starts developing autoimmune diseases. Now, let me just touch on this. I mentioned antibodies, right? An antibody is a Y-shaped protein that is used to neutralize invading viruses and bacteria. Okay, so basically the antibodies help neutralize attackers. They basically tag or label some foreign microbe as an illegal alien that must be removed from the system. So the other parts of the immune system can go in there and take over and remove it, but it also can attack it directly and neutralize it directly in some situations. But the point is that these antibodies, when they lose control right here, then you lose you become susceptible to getting all sorts of chronic infections and autoimmune diseases. Some interesting things about autoimmune diseases. They're treated with cortisol. We talked about that. And they turn off when you're pregnant. That's fascinating. So there is a mechanism that protects the growing fetus from being destroyed by your immune system. And apparently, when you're pregnant, your immune system wakes up and all your autoimmune problems disappear, which is fascinating. So we have a solution. We need to improve the immune system, not try to attack it with steroids. Or we can actually just recommend that the pregnant female stay pregnant and have about 13, 14, 20 kids, and then she'll be great through those years. Okay, that's another option. Transplanted organs, they have to take cortisone because they have their body rejects it. They develop antibodies against it. Cortisol is an anti-allergic functions. But always, autoimmune problems are always triggered by stress events. I've never met anyone that didn't have that situation. So that kind of debugs why people have autoimmune, but cortisol is a very, very, very destructive thing to your protein if it's in high amounts. So we want to apply the adrenal protocol for any of these issues right here to strengthen the actual adrenal. One last little tidbit right here. Calcium is lost to the urine with high levels of cortisol too. It's lost to the bone too. So the calcium absorption is decreased through the blocking of the vitamin D receptor. Now, what does that mean? That means when you go through high levels of stress, your vitamin D goes down because it blocks the receptor, so you can't absorb vitamin D anymore. And there's a lot of people that get sun and they still have low vitamin D. A lot of people have low vitamin D and they don't know why. The doctors don't tell them. It's probably because of high cortisol. Okay? So cortisol decreases the receptor, thereby blocking the receiving of vitamin D. And this is intimately connected to the immune system, because vitamin D, one function, is not just bone or calcium metabolism, it's immune protection.